All right, Matthew 19. All right, we are going to make a tie-in between Matthew 19 to 1 Corinthians 7, which is why we're going to read 19 again as a backdrop to 1 Corinthians 7. It came to pass when Jesus had finished these sayings, he departed from Galilee in verse number 1 of chapter number 19 of the first gospel. And it came to the coast of Judea beyond Jordan, and the great multitudes followed him, and he healed them. The Pharisees also came unto him, and they were tempting him. And they said unto him, is it lawful for a man to divorce his wife? Your King James Bible has put away, it is divorce. It's to divorce his wife for every cause. And he answered and said unto them, have you not read that he which made them at the beginning made them male and female, and said, for this cause shall a man leave father and mother, and they shall cleave or be joined to his wife, and they two shall be one flesh. Therefore, they are no more two, but are now one flesh. And what therefore God hath joined together, let no man put asunder or separate. They said unto him, why did Moses then command to give a writing of divorcement and to put her away? He said, Moses, because of the hardness of your hearts, allowed you to divorce your wives, but from the beginning it was not so. Verse number 9. And I say unto you, whosoever shall put away or divorce his wife, except it be for fornication or sexual immorality, and shall marry another, that one commits adultery. Whoever marries her for which is to be divorced or put away also commits adultery. His disciples said unto him, and this is the tie-in, if the case of the man be so with his wife, it is not good to marry. Now notice verse 11. He said unto them, all men cannot receive this saying except they to whom it is, notice this word, given. Let's pray. God, I just pray that you would just come here and just fill this place with your Holy Spirit. I know that apart from the Spirit's work today, these are nothing but words. Words with so little effectual power. God, I just pray that you would come here. Come into our midst and make this better. In Jesus' name, amen. So let's look at 1 Corinthians 7 now as we attempt to do our best to tie the two together. 1 Corinthians 7. I want you to see verse number 1 as we look at this as a backdrop to what we just read. In chapter number 19 of Matthew, they said, if this is the situation, it's just best not to get married. To which Jesus said, that's only for some. That's only for some people. That's just for those to whom it is given. So they said, it's better not to get married. And Jesus said, no, actually, that's only for a limited amount of people to whom it is given. Now notice how the church at Corinth has written to Paul almost an identical statement. I want you to see it in verse number 1. Now concerning the things wherein you wrote unto me, so they wrote to him. And when they were writing to him, this is what they said. It is good for a man not to touch a woman. It's almost identical to what the disciples. The disciples said, well, if I can't just divorce a woman for any reason, I think I'm just not going to get married. And in verse chapter number 6 of 1 Corinthians, Paul has just told them that the unrighteous shall not inherit the kingdom of God. In verse number 9, be ye not deceived, neither the fornicators, the idolaters, the adulterers, the effeminate, the abusers of themselves, of mankind, not the thieves, nor the covetous, nor the drunkards, nor the revilers, nor the extortioners. None of them are going to inherit the kingdom of God. None of them. So then, if I cannot be sexually immoral and go to heaven, then they say, it's just best that a man not touch a woman. Touching a woman there is a euphemism for sexual relations. So now let's see what Paul says in verse number 2. Nevertheless, to avoid fornication, to avoid sexual immorality. So since this is not an option for me, this not touching a woman, and because sexual immorality is such a problem, what is the solution? Let every man have his own wife and every woman her own husband. There's the solution. Because of the backdrop that sexual immorality sends me to hell. And it's so serious of a sin that it cannot be ignored. And because for most of us in this room, not touching a woman is not an option, then God's solution to the problem is this thing called holy matrimony. Nevertheless, to avoid fornication, let every man have his own wife and every woman have her own husband. And let the husband render. If you have an ESV Bible in front of you, you'll notice that they chose to translate the word render as give. It's a good, solid translation. In fact, render is translated in your King James Bible 9 other times as give. And the root word there is give. Let the husband give unto his wife due benevolence. And likewise, let the wife give unto the husband good benevolence. So now we're getting the idea. Husbands, give to the wives, and wives, give to the husbands. The wife has not power over her own body, but the husband. Likewise, the husband hath not power over his own body, but the wives. All of you that have ever heard Paul being accused of being a sexist, evidently he's not a sexist because he just put man and woman on a level playing field when it comes to the intimacy of the bedroom. He just said it's not your body, it's her body. It's not his body, it's your body. You don't own it, he don't own it. In fact, when you consummate the marriage and you become one flesh, you're literally giving up ownership of your body. It's very clear. You can't ignore it. Defraud ye not one another. Don't avoid this except for a limited period of time, and you've got to do it together in consent that you yourselves may fast and pray and then come right back together. Well, why? Why must we come right not back together? That Satan tempt you not for your lack of self-control. It's not a good thing. It's not a good thing to avoid this. It's not a good thing to get to the point in your relationship where this is not happening. Why? Because it creates opportunities for Satan to come and tempt you. Well, what is the big deal with that? What's the big deal with that? Well, verse number 9 and 10 of chapter 6 told us that the sexual immoral do not inherit the kingdom of God. So whether you realize or not, this is a gospel issue. This is a gospel issue. Paul knows nothing of the Christian who is out there chasing skirts.
That's right. That's right.
That Christian doesn't exist in Paul's mind. This duplicity is not there. Why should we care about this? Let's focus on that. Do you understand that nearly all 19 and 20-year-olds are leaving the faith? Most of our 19 and 20-year-olds walk away from the faith. If you're 21, most of them, Dan, are not in church. They grow up in Christian homes and they abandon the faith. That ought to be concerning to us. That should concern us. We want our children to stay in the faith. Yes, we want to see them saved in Thailand. We wouldn't have sent Joey Kellett there if we didn't. But man, I want to see my own son saved. My children. I speak this by permission and not a commandment, for I would that all men were even as I myself, Paul says, in a state of singleness, committed to celibacy, where he can give all of his life to the advancement of the gospel. But in verse 7, he says, every man hath his proper gift of God. One after this manner and another after that. Now, it's almost identical to what Jesus said, David, when he said, yes, for some they may be able to be celibate, but only to those that it is what?
Given.
Only to those that are given. When they said to him, well, it's best not to marry in Matthew 19. Or in this day when the Corinthians says, hey, let's just not touch women then. Hey, that may be possible for a select portion of the body of Christ to whom it is given. But to the other, they are also given a gift. And what is that gift?
Marriage.
Marriage. And there may be a time in your life when you were given the gift of marriage, and there may be a season in your life when you're given the gift of celibacy. In other words, you could go through your life with both gifts. Where do you get that idea from? Well, I'm pretty sure Paul was married. Do some studying. In order to be part of the Sanhedrin, you had to be married. In fact, at the age of 19, the Jews would talk trash about you as a male if you weren't married. You know, like I do boxers and playing video games in your parents' basement. Well, they had their own little sayings about men who weren't married at that age as well. Because the expectation was from Genesis that you would get married, you would be fruitful and multiply. This idea of living in singleness was foreign to a Jew. And Paul introduces this living in singleness as a gift of celibacy from God for the advancement of the gospel, of the kingdom. So you may have that gift, and God has given you that gift. Live it out to the furtherance of the kingdom. And if God has not given you that gift, then you get married and live within that. So why? Well, he's going to tell us. Let's keep reading. Verse 8, I say therefore to the unmarried and the widows, it is good for them to abide even as I in this state of celibacy. But if they cannot contain, let them marry, for it is better for them to marry than to burn. Now this is a very interesting word for Paul to choose here. Because in all the other instances where this word burn is used, it deals with fire. It's very interesting here. Because we assume, and perhaps we're right, that Paul is talking about burn with passion. Like burn with desire. Some translations add the word with desire there. It's not in the Greek. Can't help but to wonder, could it be the other burning? Yeah, the hell, yeah. Yeah, exactly, sister, because he just got done telling us who is not inheriting the kingdom of God, and the fornicators and the adulterers and the sexual immoral, they don't. And he's telling us that you ought to get married, and you ought to stay married, and you ought to do the married thing with the person you married, and you ought to do it enough that you're not tempted into what? Pornography, fornication, and all other sexual sins. You say, can you be declarative about which interpretation is correct? No, of course I can't. Because you know what? Both work. Both work. Marriage is a great solution for burning with passion. And marriage is a great solution to avoid hell. Amen. For sexual sins. All right, let's get on. Verse number 10. Yes. Let me get my slides there. Quickly. There we go. One more time. And unto the married, I command, yet not I, but the Lord, let not the wife depart from her husband. So now he's switching gears. And now he's going to talk to those who are married. He made his case for celibacy as a gift from God, and he made his case for marriage as a gift from God and as a means of avoiding sexual immorality. That's the case he made in verses 7 through 9. Now he's turning his attention, and he wants to talk to all those who are married. And he says, to add greater clarity and strength to his argument, he says, I command, comma, yet not I, but the Lord. Let not the wife depart from her husband. And he's going to talk about in just a moment in verse number 11, and let not the husband divorce his wife. So obviously, goal number one is that we figure out how to stay married. Could we agree on that as a church? That with this admonishment from Paul to all of us that are married, we're not supposed to get divorced. Would we agree? That's a last resort. That's the least favored course of action. So if that's the case, we got to figure out how to make this thing called marriage work. Nod your head if you'd agree with me a little bit. And that we're supposed to show our children how powerful the gospel is. Like, we believe in this huge uber gospel that forgives sins, makes us righteous, takes us to heaven, but it can't get mom and dad to live together. I mean, it's powerful, son, and you need to believe in it, but we just have irreconcilable. But it's powerful, but we... You see, remember, I'm concerned about the fact that the millennial generation is leaving the church. And we can measure to some degree the strength of our church by the number of young adults who stay in the faith and continue in the faith. That they are converted and genuinely remain disciples of the Lord Jesus Christ. That we don't have these huge exodus every single year of graduates and they just leave and leave and leave the church. That they come back and they remain part of the church. They come back from college. They're in worship services. They're church and their Lord in the town that they live in. That they continue in the faith. And I think part of that is believing that what we do here is real. That this is not a plastic religion. That the gospel we believe in makes a difference in our lives. So I want to pause right now and I want to talk about how do we make this thing called marriage work? How do we get along? How do we avoid divorce in our congregation? And I'm going to give you a whole bunch of C words and I hope you write them down. And the first one is the word care. It's probably the most important one that we'll talk about our entire morning. If you get anything out of this service, it should just be titled, sermon title, I Care. Because that's where it starts. If you two want to get along and keep this thing called marriage working, I need to know that you care. And you need to know that I care. Caring is critically important. You know what you care about. It reflects in who you are. David McManus cares about Pittsburgh Steelers football. He cares about it. He knows the team. He knows where they're going. He knows that they may get beat. He's hoping that's not the case. He has a genuine concern for the success of this team. There are others that care about their automobiles. They are clean. They are maintained. Their oil changes happen. They are safe. You know why? They care about it. Others care about grass and lawns. Other care. You pick whatever you want. Care is when I take ownership of it. It's when I want it to be successful. It shows my concern for it. Apathy is the opposite of caring. Apathy. It's where you don't give a rip. See, someone who cares about their health, they eat properly. I care about my health. I'm doing one Mountain Dew a day, 12 ounces. After all 12 ounces have been consumed, I got to go a whole 24 hours to get 12 more. If I didn't care about my weight, I would drink it all day long. It's liquid manna, okay? All right? But I have a concern. That concern works itself out in regulating the amount that I drink. See, I'm not using the word love because I love pizza and I love my wife. Yeah. You want me to reverse it? Yeah. Right. I want to talk to you about what do you care about? What do you care about? What do you genuinely and authentically care about? Because if you want to have an amazing marriage, your spouse needs to know, I care about you. You're important to me. Your health and welfare is important to me. Let me work this out. Let's flesh this out a little bit. Let's talk real practical this morning. If my wife is crying, and I'm okay with that, if I can walk away from that, if I can see her weeping, and it doesn't bother me, if it doesn't break my heart, if I'm not going, what's wrong? If the desire of my heart isn't to fix it, you don't say, he cares. You accuse me of being cold-hearted, hard-hearted, and it's obvious I don't care. You see this with children. What's wrong? My head hurts. Let's go to the doctor. Why are you taking them to the doctor? It's going to encounter your time. You're going to have to get a bill. Well, don't ask me that stupid question. I care about my child, and because you care, it manifests itself in concern. If your spouse doesn't know that you care, you don't have hope of having an amazing marriage. You have a headache? I care. You're hurting? I care. There's such a lack of care. It's this apathetic lukewarmness that's plaguing our society. All right, let's be real clear. If all you care about is yourself, you're not ready for marriage. Okay? If you are the most important person on the planet, you are not ready for marriage. Because marriage is all about caring for someone else more than yourself. I care about you. Why are we talking about this morning? I'm going to tell you why. Because I care about you. This is not a job to me. I don't just quickly whip a sermon together to check the block, to deliver something, to satisfy the congregation that I've done my job. Every single word is prayed about, begging God that you would hear this concern. Why? I want you, Grant, to have an amazing marriage when God gifts you with a wife. I want to equip you right now to have an awesome marriage. I want to talk to you about how do we get there. I want you to experience the abundant life in marriage. And it will never happen if you don't start with, I care for you. I didn't say love. Love is so nebulous. Care communicates a concern for your well-being. Why do you pray about your children's salvation? Because you care. You care. So only until your spouse realizes that you care about marriage do you have any chance of getting there. So I care about you, I care about our children, and I know that divorcing you and separating is not going to be healthy for our children because I care about you, because I care about our children. We're going to stay here, and we are going to work it out. We're going to work it out. We're not separating. We're staying together. And then I care about what the Lord thinks. I care about what He thinks. It bothers me if he thinks that I'm the selfish one that's contributing to the marriage. Let me repent and get on my face before my king and say, God, if I'm the reason this thing is separating, convict me in the recess of my heart. Yes or no? Yes. And then I care about what the Bible says. Not a fancy little book. It's my guidebook. And it tells me that I am to stay married. It directs me to stay married. It is not a pick and choose book for me. It is the book for me. I don't put it on par with something else. It is God's holy word. And because I care about you, God, and because I know that you wrote that book, and that book shows me what you care about, and because I care about you and what you care about, I care what the Bible says. And the Bible says I'm supposed to stay married. So I care. And so this care is going to work itself out in being considerate. So number one is care. Number two is you got to be considerate. You got to be considerate. I'm talking about manners. I'm talking about please, thank you, tone, volume, profanity, or the absence thereof. You can't talk to your wife like she's trash and then wonder why we don't have an awesome marriage. I need to be tender. I need to be considerate. I'm not going to call you the this word or that word. That's not going to happen. Those words aren't coming out of here. Why? Because I care about you. I'm not going to talk to you like junk and treat a Walmart cashier like she's a queen. Think about what a mixed message that sends. Think about how confusing that is to your relationship. Talking trash to your wife, and then instantly you turn the corner. Well, wait a minute. If you have enough self-control, do it here, but see? So consideration. It's when I genuinely care for you, and it manifests itself in the way I address you. And then you got to communicate. Care, be considerate. There got to be some healthy talking going on. Talking, okay, not Instagram messaging or texting. I'm talking about old-fashioned communication. That's where you put sentences together, and those sentences reflect what's in your heart, and you go back and forth, and you ask questions, and you dialogue. You actually speak to each other. You know what your needs are, what your wants are, what your desires are. So let's say you have a present courtship that's built on texting. Okay, and so now we're going to go out to dinner together. We're going to have a date, you know, a date. We're going to go and sit across from each other, and we're going to talk. So first thing we're going to do is we're going to put our phones away, aren't we? We're going to put our phones away. If we don't have enough self-control to stay away from them, we leave them in the glove box in the car. I do that sometimes. Just put it away. And then we're going to talk, have a conversation. We're not going to be interrupted rudely, and we're not going to text each other across from each other. We're going to look each other in the eye and have a dialogue. Hey, if you don't figure it out during courtship, how do you think you're going to get to it in marriage? Some of you have this bizarre idea that he'll just become this communicator when we get married. Okay? Let me tell you something. If he wasn't a communicator before, he won't be afterwards. Okay? It doesn't just change. Wait a minute. We consummated the marriage. Same guy, okay? Same guy. So care, be considerate, communicate, and compromise. Compromise. You can't always have your way, Doug. No, not that Doug. How long y'all been married, Doug and Judy? 47 years. Look right here, 47 years. That's a long time. Amen. Kevin Whiting's grandfather just passed away. They've been married 72 years or 75, one of those two numbers. What a statement. How many? 63 years. This word compromise is a give and take. It's not always about you, and it's not always about her. Let me explain something to you. If you're always the one having to give, that's going to really wear old. If you feel like every single time we come together, he wins, you are creating resentment in your wife without even realizing it. Nobody loses time and time again in a compromised situation without eventually realizing it's all about her, it's all about him. In true compromising, each one gives and takes. Each one. So number one was care. Number two is be considerate. Number three is communicate. Number four is compromise. And number five is cooperate. I know this is like uber basic this morning. I know, like, you're insulting us. Cooperate. That's where you do things together. That's what, you're a team. You come together and you work together. You accomplish things. Now, however you figure out how to do it, it doesn't matter. Lately, my wife and I have been cooperating on unloading the dishwasher. We can do it in about 90 seconds. You know why? We work together as a team. Just zoom. Done. I know this is ridiculous. I got it. I know. I'm talking about the mundane tasks that oftentimes are either easy and we knock them out, or they become difficult and they create other issues in marriages. Kitchens stacked with dishes like this. Cabinets full of junk. Counters covered with stuff. It's your job. Learn to cooperate. Learn to do things together. Learn to get along and work together. Two adults can knock out a load of laundry, I mean, in uber fast. You looked at me, he's like, I'm talking about folding clothes. We came to church this morning, and we're talking about folding clothes. Like, you just converge on them, and you just make it happen, and suddenly it's done. Or you go to the, quote, man cave, like you reminded me, Doug. Who in the world ever came over the man cave? Why in the world would you get married if you want a man cave? What happened to a family room? In the family room, the family used to come together and we would do things together. Now it's the place for me to go hide away and forget that I'm married. If you need a man cave, you're not ready to be married. I'm not talking about workshop. You got a workshop? Go out there and get something done. Productive, edifying, build something, make a difference. There's a lot of difference between a man cave and a workshop. If it's all about you, you're not ready to be married. You got to cooperate. You got to work together. Figure out what each one does well and do it together. You got to confess. You got to confess. This is my fault. I was the rude one. Sorry. Please forgive me. I contributed to this argument. We wouldn't be yelling right now if it wasn't for me. Please forgive me. True and honest confessions do wonders to relationships. And then finally, and the last one, you got to be committed. You got to be committed. You got to be committed. If you're not committed to the end, you're going to struggle. The former pastor of this church would say on a regular basis, everything begins with a commitment. And you know what? He was right. Everything begins with a commitment. You want to accomplish something? You want to save $1,000 this year? It starts with a commitment. You want to stay married? It starts with a commitment. I commit to caring about you. And because I have committed about caring for you, it will manifest itself out in the way I live my life. All right, we're done. Very practical things. But if she departs, Paul says, I know the world I'm living in. I know the fallen nature of the world I'm living in. I know the brokenness of what we're dealing with. I know the hardness of the hearts of those at Corinth. So if she does depart, if she doesn't heed the requirement, if they don't figure it out, if she has to depart, if she separates, if they leave, let her remain unmarried or be reconciled to her husband. And this is huge. There are going to be times when you have to depart. I know it. I know it. It's dangerous. You have to depart. He's abusive. You may have to depart. You may have to. You might have to separate. I'm sorry. We're sorry. Your church is not there to abandon you when you depart. We're there for you. But under that criteria, that's what you've got. That's what you've got right there. This is not Sean Harris. Paul says, remain unmarried or be reconciled to your husband. So you don't depart to your friend's house and set up an eHarmony.com account. Your church at that point is struggling at saying, how are we going to support you when you're already on the hunt for a new partner? It's obvious you're not following the guidance of the text, because the guidance of the text is remain unmarried and be open for reconciliation. If you're already flirting with the next honey that you can find, you're not focused on reconciliation. If you depart that night to go to a singles bar, you're not open for reconciliation. We cannot rally behind you if you don't follow the biblical admonishments. Don't expect us to ignore you as you're chasing skirts. We can't do that. We used the illustration this morning, the 8:30 service, of Brian because he's one of the pastors. And Brian loves basketball, David. He loves to play basketball on Monday. So let's say that Brian and Lauren have a knockout, drag-out fight, and they're separate for a period of time. Brian is our youth pastor. Lauren's his wife. Michael's their son, and she's expecting again. Are they going with David? I heard it was David is the name. But in any case, that's immaterial. Two children, two boys. Brian abandons his wife. She separates. They're on the rocks. We can support both of them, if they both remain committed to celibacy during their separation and reconciliation, one being reconciled one to another during that time. Brian can't show up at men's basketball after he's been chasing skirts on the weekend. We cannot ignore that. When can he continue playing men's basketball? When he remains celibate and he's focusing on what? Reconciliation. We can't ignore that abandonment. So if you want to stay in your church family and you want to be committed to the body of Christ and you're going through a period of separation and you want the body of Christ to rally behind you, then you must remain unmarried and be ready to be reconciled. And it's both. It's not just him or her. It's both. It's either one, both genders. So you have to have a legitimate reason for departing. A legitimate reason. Someone asked about defining what that legitimate reason is. Well, there are some that's very easy, and there's others that's almost impossible to define. And we cannot get into the business of articulating all the reasons like a checklist. We can't do that. That's like the Jews that added to the law, and they just came up with rules and rules and rules and rules. What does it mean not to work on the Sabbath? So then they started defining it. How many feet could you walk? How much weight could you carry? And we can't do that when it comes to abuse. There's some things that we're going to know it right away. Your eyes are black and blue. Who did that? My husband. Hey, that's abuse. It's a no-brainer. There are other things that are much more difficult to define. Much more difficult to define. If you believe you have a legitimate reason for departing, you need to talk to others about what they think about. I said others. I did not say me. I am not the arbitrator, like, come see the Pope. No. No. Find three sisters in Christ and independently ask them the exact same question and be open for correction. Find three deacons if you're a male and ask them objectively what they think. Get a plurality before you're going to go down this course of action, because there's no one single person that can say, I am the official definer of abuse. It doesn't work that way. And every single human being is different. Every one of them are different. What you think is abuse, someone else might think, are you kidding me? But to them, it's serious. And it's not our job to discount that and say, suck it up. No, we need to take that legitimately. So now, what about when I can move on? Well, here are my two choices. Remain unmarried or be reconciled. Are there any exceptions? Well, I want to talk about that. I want to talk about those exceptions. The goal is that neither party divorces. That's the goal. If I am a believer and my wife leaves me, her actions should send me into serious introspection. Would you agree with that? Amen. John and Joan, how long y'all been married?
43 years.
43 years. Joan walks out on you and says, John, I can't take it anymore. We're done. Well, that's your problem. No. No. No, no. A serious believer is going to spend some time on their face before the Lord asking themselves, what did I do to contribute to that person walking out? How? If you don't have a, I don't care if you leave, those words should never come out of your mouth. That should never, walk if you want. No. No. A believer doesn't say those flippant things like that. You know why? He cares. She cares. The one that departs must be open to reconciliation until the door is shut. When's the door shut? Well, my opinion is the door is shut when a remarriage occurs. Unrepentant sexual immorality or remarriage. Pastor Sean, he's on his third honey since he separated us. It's obvious he's just an adulterer. You know, I think I could agree with you. Yeah, you know what? I think in that case, I certainly could agree with you. Pastor Sean, they're remarried. They're married and they've had a kid together. Well, according to Deuteronomy 24, you're not to marry them. Even if he was to get divorced, she's not a candidate to get reunited. So at that point, the door shuts. The door shuts. To the rest, Paul says, I, not the Lord, that if a brother has a wife who's an unbeliever and she consents to live with him, he should not divorce her. If any woman has a husband who's an unbeliever and he consents to live with her, she should not divorce him. Folks are staying married even in a case where they have an unbelieving husband or an unbelieving spouse. And Paul says the reason is that either one can contribute to holiness. You have an unbelieving wife. You have an unbelieving husband. We have those exact situations in this church. Do you know that? In our membership. And she's a member and he's not. He's a member and she's not. And they're in a situation where they married an unbeliever or they became believers during the marriage. And Paul says, if you're willing to stay married, if he's willing to stay, if she's willing to stay, you stay in there. You stay right there. Why? You have a sanctifying impact. You bring holiness into that marriage. You bring holiness to those children. Are you willing to give up the holiness impact that you have? He or she is not to leave because the sanctifying impact he or she can have on the other spouse. And now we get to verse 15. And it is very controversial, church. This is the difficult verse. This is the verse that the church is not united on. We have different opinions of this. Verse 15 says, but if the unbeliever depart, let him depart. A brother or sister is not under bondage in such cases, but God has called us to peace. Now, that middle part right there about bondage is where we struggle. A brother or sister is not under bondage in such cases. What does Paul mean there? This is one of those verses that you wish you could call him up. Could we get a little clarification, Paul? What does it mean not to be in bondage anymore? Does that mean that they're not bondage to that marriage? Or does that mean that they're free to be remarried? And everyone has a different opinion. Even on our pastoral staff, we have different opinions on this. And you know what? I'm okay with that. I am okay with that. We don't have to have perfect unity on every aspect. Let's talk about it. What does this word under bondage or enslaved mean? What is going on here? Is this the verse that gives the liberty to encourage remarriage to a believer? You guys have heard me talk about remarriage before. And people have said to me, why are you saying that? Why in the world are you encouraging remarriage in the body of Christ? Aren't they to stay in their current state, whatever that is? There's a couple ideas here. Does not enslaved mean that the believing spouse is not obligated to seek reconciliation to the unbelieving spouse who abandoned him or her? Or, as the majority of interpreters, according to the ESV Study Bible, say, that now that means that they are now free to obtain a legal divorce and the freedom to marry someone else. And we have different opinions. Different opinions. Let's get a scenario up here. Come on, there it is right there. Scenario number one. Christian female marries Christian male at the age of 21. Within 6 months of their marriage, one of them has abandoned the other and is out there with drugs, alcohol, and sex. Is he now obligated or she now obligated to a life of celibacy? Or do they have the freedom to obtain a divorce and then, if God was to permit it, give them a second chance? And the church is divided. And we are not going to pick a team. because people have different interpretations of this. They really do. Some say that the bondage means that they're no longer in bondage to that marriage, but they need to remain single and celibate. Others say, no, that's still in bondage, because if you burn, you're still struggling. I'm going to draw a parallel, and then I'm going to wrap it up. This is just me thinking. Remember, I'm not the man of God. I don't have any divine unction. I do the same thing you do. I pray and try my best to understand something. That's all. Let's change gears for just a moment, and then we'll go back to that gear. When it comes to adoption, and you have a situation where a child is abandoned by their parents, we do not say to that child, because of the abandonment that you incurred, you can never have a father and a mother. You must live as an orphan for the rest of your life. What do we say? We say it's a glorious thing when someone decides to adopt you, don't we? We celebrate adoption. Yes or no?
Yes.
We say that adoption is gospel-centered. We say that it reflects what Christ has done for us and that we've been adopted into the family of God. We don't say, hey, child, I know you were abandoned by your mom and abandoned by your father, and that just stinks to be you, and now you have to be in this state of orphan for the rest of your life. We say, no, if God permits and in his sovereignty, he brings someone into your life that desires to adopt you and bring you into their family, that is a reflection of the gospel. And what I'm going to suggest as one preacher, just one preacher, that the same thing can happen when second marriages.
Amen. That's right.
Now, don't misunderstand me. I am not saying for a minute that we enter into our first marriage with the idea of, if this doesn't work out, I'll just get another one. I'm not suggesting that for a moment. I am not suggesting that, man, as soon as that one didn't work out, I can start chasing skirts over here. But what I am saying is that when a married person has been abandoned and there's no hope of reconciliation, they're remarried, they're in a different country, they've got a whole new life, I believe that it can be a very gospel-centered thing for a husband to step in and say, I am going to marry you. I want to redeem you. I want to buy you out of that. I don't mean buy. Don't misunderstand me. I'm trying to draw parallels. I'm just trying to draw parallels between what Christ has done for us in the gospel, which is he's delivered us from our state of despair and brought us into a right relationship with the Father. And I believe there are certain cases where a single woman in our congregation can be delivered from that state if she's been given the gift of marriage and someone wants to do that. And in those cases, we as a church ought to celebrate the fact that they are being delivered. That's all I'm suggesting. And I'm very okay if you disagree with me. I'm very okay with that. Very okay. I think I have a fair case to be made with the parallel of adoption. And I'm going to push the envelope a little bit more and say that when that father says to those children that she had from that first marriage, I'm going to treat you as my own, that's even more gospel-centered. When he says, I want you to be my wife, like Boaz and Ruth, and I'm going to take your children and I'm going to adopt them into my family, and we're going to take what Satan meant for evil and we are going to turn it into good. And I know this has been horrific, but today we are starting a new life. This is like a new creature in Christ, and we're going to redeem this thing. This is my idea. If you don't agree, I'm okay with that. I really am. If your view is a higher view, which is no, she has to stay in a state of that situation because of what happened, I can see where you're saying that. I wish Paul provided a little bit more clarity, but he doesn't. In verse 39, he says that the wife is bound by the law as long as her husband lives, but if her husband be dead, she is at liberty to be married to whom she will. I'm just going to suggest to you that there's sometimes when the husband as good as dead. And what I mean by that is when he's abandoned all his responsibility and he's remarried and there's no hope of being reconciled, then in that cases, I believe that she is just as free as the widow is in verse 39. But again, that is just an interpretation. Let's pray. Father in heaven, I pray that in 99% of the time, all this talk of remarriage is not necessary, because husbands and wives figure out how to care, they figure out how to be considerate, and they figure out how to communicate, and they figure out how to compromise, and they figure out how to confess, they figure out how to cooperate, and they remain committed. But God, in those situations where it doesn't work out, I pray that we would not be a church that condemns, that we would consider the reality that apart from an amazing wife that we have, we could be in that same state. And so we show love and grace and mercy and compassion and concern, and we rally around those that are struggling as long as they remain committed to celibacy and reconciliation until there's no hope. And I pray this in Jesus' mighty name. Amen.